talks. And I will try to paraphrase them to Swamiji. So a few words about the Vivekananda Study Circle. It works, it is centered in IISc and works with the objective of providing opportunity and guidance to interested youth to acquire a clear understanding of life, values and culture in the light of the life and teachings of Swami Vivekananda. To this effect, the students of IISc meet every Tuesday and read and discuss the message of Swami Vivekananda and Indian philosophy in the light of modern thought and modern needs. So I'd like to start with one Shanti mantra. Om Sahana Vavatu Sahanau Bhunaktu Sahaviryam Karavavahai Tejasvinavadhitamastu Mavidvishavahai. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. We are very glad that we have Swami Brahma Vidhanandaji amongst us today. He will speak on the topic consciousness and the self in science and Vedanta. A brief introduction to his all-pervading personality. Swami Brahma Vidhanandaji is a traditional and contemporary teacher of Vedanta and founder of Arsha Vidya Foundation, a trust dedicated to Vedic wisdom teachings. He has impacted the lives of seekers, youth, professionals in India and abroad. Swamiji studied the Gita, Upanishads and the Brahma Sutras under Pujya Swami Dayananda Saraswati Ji at Sandipani Sandhyalaya in Mumbai. He went to study advanced Vedic texts under Swami Tarananda Giri and Swami Harihara Tirtha. He is also a very accomplished martial arts expert. So I'll sing a brief Vandana, and after that Swamiji will start the session, and throughout the session I'd request all of you to turn on your videos if possible, so that Swamiji particularly wanted that, so that he feels that he's talking to a live audience. So this is a Swami Vivekananda Stotram, a Vandana for him.
Murta Maheshwaram Ujjala Bhaskaram Ishtam Amarana Ravandyam Murta Maheshwaram Ujjala Bhaskaram Ishtam Amarana Ravandyam Vande Vedatanu Mujjita Garhita Kanchana Kamini Bandham Murta Maheshwaram Ujjala Bhaskaram Ishtam Amarana Ravandyam Koti Bhanukara Deepta Singha Maho Kati Tata Kaupina Vantam Abhirabhi Hunkara Nadita Dingmukha Prachanda Tandava Nrityam Murta Maheshwaram Ujjala Bhaskaram Ishtam Amarana Ravandyam.
Right.
भुक्ति मुक्ति कृपा कटाक्ष प्रेक्षण अघदल विदल नदाक्ष बाल चंद्र धरमिंदु वंद्यमिह नौमि गुरु विवेकानंद मूर्त महेश्वरम उज्ज्वल भास्करम इष्ट ममरन रवंद्यम वंदे वेद तनुमूर्जित गर्हित कांचन कामिनी बांधम मूर्त महेश्वरम उज्ज्वल भास्करम इष्ट मरन रवंद्यम इष्टम मरन रवंद्यम इष्टम मरन रवंद्यम
So I now request Swamiji to start this session, and again requesting all of you to make it an interactive one and turn on your videos. Thank you.
Yeah, nice to be here with all of you first. Okay. Though I can see only a few of you still, I'm happy to be with all of you. Now, if you're looking at the whole question of science and Vedanta and everything, you know, from times immemorial, people have looked at the world that you see and wondered what it is about. Always wondered what the heck is all this about. If you expressed it in emotional terms, you became a poet. Otherwise, you became a philosopher. If you put it in mathematical terms, you became a scientist. Because you always had to do the math. No? So this has been going on. And we will look at it from the basic thing of science and Vedanta, which in many ways are two extremes. There is a lot of effort to make Vedanta scientific. But I belong to the old school, to a more traditional school, which says there may be a lot of aspects which are scientific, but Vedanta is not scientific as a whole. Not meant to be. Because there are various disciplines of knowledge which are not scientific but still valid. Finance is not scientific. It's a valid discipline. In fact, many of you may have found that some of you, your projects, scientifically valid projects, cannot be done because finance is not available. So financially, we have to overrule some things. It's a valid discipline of knowledge, though not scientific. We have a lot of social sciences. Social science is an attempt to make it scientific. Okay, it's not really scientific. So when people are, when I'm talking about scientific things, I would always talk in terms of physics, biology, okay? All these subjects, chemistry, neurosciences, psychiatry. Psychology is valid, and I think Institute of Science has a phenomenally great, phenomenally good psychology section. In fact, Dr. Seshadri was a legend. I don't know how many of the newer generation know him, because he must be my age. So he must have retired, man. Okay, retired long back. I At least 7, 8 years back, he must have retired, but he was a legend in his lifetime. The great psychology section. Psychiatry is scientific, psychology is not. So there you have another thing coming up. So let us not be under the mistaken impression that all of Vedanta is scientific. It is not. Okay. Now, coming to science, you all are the experts in science, okay? Just to give an overview, when we looked at the whole question of science, we always maintained in science a subject-object divide. We always maintained that because as an observer, you have to be objective. So you had to maintain the distance between the subject and object, between what you're studying. You have to take yourself out of the equation and watch that thing. Study it. Whether it was studying a naturally occurring phenomenon or trying to replicate it in a laboratory setup, in a control setup, you always had to do this, which worked fine for a long time. The science started when? From Greco-Roman times. Okay. Yeah, from Greco-Roman times. So it got a flip around maybe the 16th century or whatever. And it worked. In fact, all Newtonian physics, by the end of the 19th century, people were talking about that everything in science had already been discovered. It is only a question of fine-tuning your measurements. 19th century, the scientists were talking like that. But then the whole change happened in the 20th century. Well, a lot of changes happened in the whole thing, yeah. Einsteinian physics came into the picture with the relativity of time, space, the whole thing. All right. But still, that subject-object divide seemed to be working okay. Until we studied quantum physics and the whole equation changed. Why? The observer seemed to be influencing the observed. Fundamental difference. And sometimes the observed is responding to the observation. You remember all those famous, this thing about simultaneously creating two light photons, sending it through slits. All of you, I'm sure, are familiar with this whole thing. Even as a layman like me, I'm familiar. And even if those two photons are separated in time and space, if one chooses one option, the other will choose the other option. Opposite and complementary. So are you saying the photon is self-conscious, is self-aware? Are you saying that? And then the question whether it's a wave or a particle. And in layman terms, scientists came up with funny explanation. It sounds very funny for the layman. Until you observe it behaves like a wave, when you observe it, it collapses into a particle. Hey, what happened? Did the photon get self-conscious mode and suddenly froze itself? Somebody is watching me. I don't like to be watched. Yeah, I mean, what happened? I'm joking, of course. Yeah. So that means, now look at earlier also. Let's leave this photon for the time being. Even earlier, when you are saying that the reality is out there and we have to study that reality, how are we studying it? Remember, reality in science is very existentialist. It matches with the existential philosophers. What you can see, what you can hear, what you can touch and taste and smell. This is reality. That means the outer reality is dependent upon your observations. The famous question, if the tree falls in the forest and nobody were to hear it or see it, has the tree fallen? Many people will be tempted to say, of course the tree has fallen. Because the existential reality exists independent of me. Does it? It looks like that when the grosser objects, the heavier objects, which have a very short wavelength, it looks like that. But at the level of the photon, what happens? What you call matter becomes a collapsed wave. That means what? Matter is dependent on your observation. Otherwise, it exists only as possibilities. So, like the 19th century ether that has been pervading space, there was a theory like that. I don't think even science students are even aware of it now. That old is. You shifted to space-time continuum. How are you going to explain this? And then to the string theory and postulating multiple dimensions where multiple possibilities of the photon choosing can exist. Why? You want to avoid the question of consciousness. Of the photon responding to the consciousness observer. So what you call as outer reality does not exist independent of your perceptions. Because if it is fivefold in terms of touch, taste, smell, sound, etc., enhanced by your technology, is it really out there? Are you observing what is out there? This laptop, it seems so solid. Is it really that solid laptop? Or is it perception, colors, etc., sound, touch, feel? I don't want to taste it. What is it? I mean, the whole question of reality seems to be dependent upon you being conscious of it. How else do you think a thing is there? This is common in science and Vedanta. Vedanta also says that to say a thing is there, there should be someone who knows it. We call it Pramana Siddham, what is established by means of knowledge, which will include your logic, your inference, which will include your deductive logic, your comparisons, etc. All that is fine. All there are various extensions of the means of knowledge available for you. So the whole world that I see is based on that. It seems to be intimately connected. Yeah. To my observation, my being conscious about it. Now the question will come, what about time and space? There is a time when it was taken as eternal. There is a time when space and time were taken as constants, always there. Until Einstein came and changed the whole picture. In fact, what is this thing that we call time other than a concept in your mind? Is there really something called time? It's not an object. Is space an object tangible like this laptop? Do you have a photon of space or an atom of space? You don't. is really time and space matter? I wish we could say it doesn't matter. These are fundamental questions in science. I'm not doing it together. Still, the overview of science, I'm not a scientist. I have an overview of the picture, of the philosophy behind science. Because every branch of discipline has its own philosophy, its own paradigms, its own structures. Without that, cannot exist. No discipline of knowledge can exist without that. So time and space are only mental constructs. Consists of your brain, of your animal brain, your human brain, so that you can place events and events and objects in it. This is what the scientists are talking, not Vedanta. What Vedanta says, I'll come to. Maybe similar in these things. So if this is the case, then what is the question of consciousness? There also, science tends to be very materialistic. Now, I'm not talking about materialism as opposed to spiritual, this thing. No. By materialistic, I'm talking about dependent on matter. That matter at a certain level expresses consciousness. Because what is this thing that we call consciousness in science? Brain functions, your ability to think, feel, organize information. In fact, in pure science, there is nothing called mind. Mind is nothing but the information gathering and organizing capacity of your brain. So that's why I'm saying it's a materialistic paradigm, because when matter evolves at a particular time, at a particular stage of the evolution, it starts expressing life or consciousness. They're very materialistic paradigm. All right, fine. It's manifest consciousness. That means your fundamental principle that there is no event without an observer is at risk. Is very highly at risk. Why? Because according to science, the creation of the world, if I may use the word creation, or how the world came about, the theory accepted now is a Big Bang. And if consciousness evolved a billion years after the Big Bang, who was the observer of the Big Bang? Did it have an observer? Or are you observing in retrospect? So until you observe the Big Bang, all of us are only probabilities, potentialities. And there can be parallel universe with different potentialities, different manifestations. Because we are not yet collapsed into matter. Is that true? Or do you feel the matter here? We can't be that. Or can we say that this is matter, but the Big Bang is still not? Because we are not observed, it is not collapsed into matter. Then how did we come about it? You see, there are certain fundamental issues at stake. Because the observer is important in science. I'm still sticking myself only to the scientific paradigms. Okay? I'll come into Vedanta shortly. But it becomes an important paradigm. So the latest kid on the block, as far as science is concerned, is biocentrism. I'm sure all of you have heard of that term. Instead of keeping physics at the center, of study of the universe, they demand that biology is kept at the center because the study of consciousness is possible in biology. Study of consciousness is not in physics. The study of consciousness is in biology, neurosciences, etc. But then the same problem exists because there also it is taken as an evolute of matter. So whether physics is at the center or biology of the center, the fundamental problem of the observer is not yet solved. And the question of that photo on Roma responding to my observation, it seems to put the observer observed divide at risk. Not at risk, it's demolishing it, actually speaking. Because if my very act of observation is going to change that, change what is being observed, then how do I maintain my objectivity anymore? And even objective is here. All that I am experiencing about the objective world is here in terms of my perceptions. So Vedanta flips it around. We say what was there in the beginning was nothing but pure consciousness. Satyam jnanam anantam brahma. That consciousness alone was there in the beginning. And matter, etc., is a manifestation of that. Manifestation, not creation. But before I go into that, I want to bring in another point, which is comes from the paradigm of science itself. When you study what happened after the Big Bang, if the Big Bang was a little bit more forceful than what it was, the universe would be flying apart at such speeds that life will not be possible. If it was slower, we would be too close to the sun, no life would be possible. You all can do the math if you want to, okay? Or read books which does the maths for it. So in that case, it seems to be that the universe is favoring consciousness to manifest. Because they favored life to manifest. All the conditions are just right for life to manifest. At least on Earth, we don't know how many Earths are there. The possibilities are there. I'm sure more intelligent beings have sent probes to Earth and decided we better leave the species alone. They're destroying their own planet. They'll come here and destroy our planet also. Let us leave them alone. Let them kill themselves. We want nothing to do with these characters. But whatever, jokes apart, the fact remains that the very order that is there seems to be favorable for life to manifest, for consciousness to manifest. That there seems to be an order in the whole thing. In the way the laws, etc., evolved and we have understood it. Though the favorite thing is, of course, first there was only chaos, and out of chaos, the universe came into being. I'm sure all of you will find that a little difficult to follow if you're a little bit objective about it. Why? Take this. Take the 26 alphabets of the English language. Okay? 26 alphabets of the English language. Put in a bag. Chaotic, no? The number, the alphabets are in a chaotic condition. Put your hand in and grab a few. You make this word building exercise. So make a word, multiple words, maybe a sentence, Shake the bag more, create more words, create more, keep on doing this until you build a library of books containing the knowledge in the English literature. Only in English, forget other languages, only in English. You think a billion years will be enough for it? Random selection, okay? It's all pure random. We are talking about random selection in evolution of matter. That from these alphabets of the English language, by random selection, you're creating a library of books that I can find behind one of yours. Imagine creating out of this random selection the works of Shakespeare. Wordsworth, Tennyson. Let's make it more precise. Works of Einstein, Stephen Hawking. All this precise knowledge coming by random selection. You think a billion years will be enough for it? You think the age of the universe will be enough to create that? Unless you have a supercomputer which is programmed to do it. Programmed to do it, you are introducing intelligence there externally. It is no more random. It is no more chaos. You are on dangerous footing there. Why dangerous footing? Because then the idea of a grand design comes in. Grand design according to science, not religion. I am leaving religion out of the picture for the time being. That way all Occidental religions talk about a grand design for producing. They are not talking about that. Let us leave that. I'm talking in science itself, there had to be a grand design because order and knowledge and arrangement. How did that come in? Seem to be on very shaky ground. All this is what is developed from the philosophy of science, okay? All this is from the philosophy of science. Then comes the question of Vedanta. We flip it around and say, oh, what was there was only one consciousness. From consciousness, it manifested. What is the first manifestation? Avyakta. The unmanifest condition. What is known as Maya, which would include your dark matter in it. Because a major portion of the matter found in the world is dark matter. You students of science, you all know that already. That the amount of dark matter in the world is huge. And the matter that we are studying is a minuscule amount. Avyakta. From that, the cosmic mind came into the picture. Intelligence. The sense of I, Mahat Buddhi Ahankaram, the sense of the I, cosmic I, which includes the whole thing. From there, subtle things, gross things, there is a dialectical theory of manifestation, a dialectical theory, not a scientific. And for grossification, it talks about Akasha, Vayu, Agni, Apa, Prithvi. Akasha, space, air. They call it elements. They're not elements. They're not elements. You know the element table. How many elements are there? 132 now or 108 or what? I forget. It's a long time since I looked at the table. The periodic table. Whatever. My time when I studied it, there was barely 100. No. Air is not an element, but they were called Bhutas. For want of a better term, any Besant time, somebody translated it as elements. Okay. Because The translator did not know Sanskrit, and the people who knew Sanskrit did not know English. So you can imagine what type of translations came about. And people have been following the same translations without changing them. Well, that's one problem of the academic studies. When one thing is accepted, the same thing continues, even if there is a mistake. Fire, water. Water is a what? Air is a mixture, water is a compound. Not elements. Earth. Earth is not one. All elements are there in Earth. Not one element. But they have a model. They just have a model. Why? Because explanation of the creation is not the aim of Vedanta. Is not the purpose of Vedanta. They just have to be able to understand, oh, there is something called gold, which is dependent on your observation. How you see the world is through your will, and that's why you say it's there. The world is pramana siddham, is established by a means of knowledge. It is there. So we all live in the world that we think it is, not in the world that it is. So that's what Vedanta looked at. It is not meant to explain the world, except in very simple terms, block term, because it wants you to understand the consciousness. Its job is not to understand the world. Science also started with wanting to understand what is the truth behind the world. Science started with that. But then it has got caught up in the details of the world, isn't it? That's why the whole thing has got branched into so many different disciplines. And rightly so, because the knowledge is huge. Whereas Vedanta's job is not that. Vedanta's job is to only understand what consciousness is about. Now, why do you need Vedanta to understand consciousness? Because the consciousness is not observable like how the world is observable. By its very definition, it becomes like that. It's not something that you can see or hear or touch or smell or feel. By very definition. Because it is that which existed before the world came into existence. Okay. Sorry. Sometimes I think Sunday evening the Wi-Fi gets overloaded. Okay. So it goes off. So I switched over to my phone. I mean, all of you can hear me, no? See me, hear me? All right.
Yes, Swami.
Yeah. So when that is the question, can consciousness being, it's not something that you can observe or see or then the question will be, if it is not available for observation, etc., how do you even say it is there? Here is where certain things come in. Okay, I'm not going to go into the question of pramana yet, unless you all want me to go. If it comes up as a question, I will do that. But before that, if something was there before the universe manifested itself, can that entity be limited by time and space? Obviously not. Time and space is yet to come. By whatever process, Big Bang or otherwise, by whatever process the universe has come, Time and space came later. This consciousness existed before. So by his very, by that same logic, that consciousness should be unlimited by time and space. Then the question is, if it is unlimited by time and space, can it change to become this universe? Because all change is within time and space. All change is within time and space. And consciousness is there before time and space. So it is not bound by time and space. If it is not bound by time and space, then what you see as the universe is only a manifestation. It is not a creation. It's only an appearance. A common example we give in Vedanta for simplification is my kurta. Can all of you see it? The kurta is nothing but a manifestation of cloth. Where is the kurta? There is no kurta, really speaking. Where is the kurta? What you, the feel of the kurta is the feel of the cloth. The weight of the kurta is the weight of the cloth. The fall of the kurta is the fall of the cloth. What is this thing that you are calling kurta? And sometimes if the tailor doesn't have enough material, it becomes a kurti. The shortened version of kurta. So, what is this thing that you have got? The same cloth in a appearing in a different form, isn't it? In South, if you go to some of the sadhus, which you meet some of the sadhus there, they won't wear a kurta. They'll just wear an upper cloth. You must have seen it. South Ramakrishna Mission sadhus also wear an upper cloth. North kurta is more popular. And I definitely like it because more comfortable to travel by public transport. I'm sure all the girls who wear dupattas know how difficult it is to travel by public transport when you're wearing a dupatta and traveling by public transport. In a particular form, it is called this. So the whole, when you look at this whole universe, what is it but names and forms? What is there is one existing consciousness. The whole world, whole universe is nothing but names and forms. And form follows function. Therefore, there is name, there is form, there is function. And because there are names and forms and function, there are relationships. Sambandha. There is interaction. There are permutations and combinations. You get the universe. So you're postulating a consciousness. But how can you even know that the consciousness is there? A very important point in Vedanta. Even as a student of science, this becomes a very important point. That the consciousness is self-existing and self-evident. It is self-evident. How do you say that? Now you remember you have taken yourself to be the observer, observing the events that are happening. Tell me, how do you know you exist? How do you know you exist? You see, hey, am I there? You have to see like that. You have to touch. Oh, yeah, I'm there. You have to taste. Like a baby, put my tongue in it and taste. You have to do that. To know I am there. How do you know I am? I exist. Not what you are. I don't want to know what you are. You are a scientist, you are a sadhu, you are this. Forget all that. The fact that you exist, how do you know? The tree fell in the forest, you knew it because you saw it or heard it. How do you know you are there? Do you follow any logic? Any process of inference? Swamiji, I have a girlfriend, and girls today are very smart. They will go on a date only with existing guys, not with non-existing guys. You follow the logic like that? I'm sure what some of the guys are thinking, Swamiji, they don't know I exist. Doesn't matter. There is always somebody for someone. Someone for them, everyone is there. Not a problem. So either you can find someone and be happily married, or you can become a philosopher along with being a scientist. Okay. That's what Socrates said. The one who began all this inquiry in the Western world as far as science is concerned. Okay. Now look at it. How do you know you exist? You know you exist. Is there a doubt about that? You know I am. Is there any doubt on that? No, you know I am. Of course I am there. What I am, I'm not asking. What I am, there can be a thousand different opinions. I just want to know whether you are there or not. I know I am. Main hoon na. Like Shah Rukh Khan, all of us can say, main hoon na. I'm there. All right, I'm there. How do you know that? What process of meditation do you need to know I am? Nothing. It is self-evident. The only thing in the world that is self-evident is the conscious observer. That I, the conscious being, you know you I am. In Vedanta, we give an example, we say, a light does not require another light to be seen. Like this guy in Delhi, winter, he is sleeping under the razai. Delhi winters can be quite nice. Nice, yeah. About 4 degrees. 5 degrees in the night. Rishikesh, where I stayed, is colder. Okay, night temperatures touch zero quite often, and you don't have central heating and everything. Okay. Nowadays in our ashram there is some central heating. You know what is the central heating? You'll keep a portable heater in the center of the room. That is called central heating. Okay. Anyway, so Rishi, there it gets colder. Anyway. That apart, this guy is sleeping in Delhi under the razai, and he sees the sun moving around. He's awake, half awake, and he asks his son, "Beta, see whether the sun is up, so that I'll have a cup of tea sitting in the sun, getting warming my old bones." Very nice experience. Sit in the sun early morning and have a cup of tea. It's something of your own charm. I'm sure those who are from Calcutta also has experienced it, because Calcutta also gets quite cold. And the sun, instead of going out, is opening drawers. Arre beta, kya kar raha hai? What are you doing? Pitaji, I'm looking for the torch. Why? To see whether the sun has come up or not. You don't need it. You don't need a light to see another light. Similarly, I am is known to you, self-evident. Everyone knows I am. Then to go through the process of Vedanta, because that should be my topic, isn't it? The only question worth asking or answering in Vedanta, who are you? Who are you? Hey, what you see is what you get. Okay? Who are you? What do you mean, who are you? What you see is what we get. Me? This is me, up to my fingertips. Outside there is a world. In between also is a world, okay? Yeah, if a bullet passes through, bach gaya. It passed through, it didn't hit me, no? It didn't touch me, so I'm fine. Yeah. Though many people will get scared, oh my God, the bullet passed here. Passed there, no? A miss is as good as a mile. Okay, you have to have a little bit of war experience and things like that to go through that stage of telling things, okay? Yeah. Anyway, so this is what you are. Body sit, I sit, body walks, I walk, body talks, I talk, isn't it? I equals body. Okay, very fine. I'm tall, I'm short, etc. All based on the body. Now your own experience, okay? Your own observations. This guy comes and tells me, Swamiji, I said, what happened to you? You're not sitting properly. Swamiji, my whole body is paining. What happened? I went to the gym and had such a, the guy, the trainer put me through such a workout. My whole body is, one second. What did you say? My body. Just before you're saying, I am the body. Can both be the same? My pen. Can it be I pen? No, mine, no. My phone. But you have iPhones. But it is not iPhone, okay? And this is not iPhone. I find it too expensive, waste of money. Sadhu thinking, keep things simple. So, okay, we bring in a very simple logic. And what is that logic? What you are aware of, you are different from. What is subject to your observation, you are independent of that. Is the body subject of your observation? Yeah. How do I know my body is aching, etc.? I'm aware of it. I can observe the body, I'm aware of the body. In fact, I'm aware of the body so intimately you don't know. If I go to a doctor and say, I have a backache, the doctor will generally put you through some tests, x-rays, nothing wrong with you. But doctor, I have a backache. Can the doctor deny that you don't have a backache? So he'll have to give an explanation. He said, oh, it's postural. Maybe you're sitting too long in the pandemic in front of a screen. Something he'll have to tell you. That he can't deny the fact that you have a backache. That can't be denied. So you're aware of the body. You have to be independent of the body. It's your body all right, okay? I have one body to maintain, both of you. Imagine having to eat for two, exercise for two and everything. Oh my God. A relationship is problematic, you know. Imagine having a second body. I'm not against relationships, okay? Please have it. Enjoy them. You all are young, enjoy that. You must taste everything in life. At least once. Okay? Yeah. So enjoy all the good things in life. But my body, not I body. How are you aware of the body? My mind. Mind means, what do you mean? Either you can mean emotions or you can mean thinking. Knowledge. Emotions, are you aware of? Do you care for that guy? All right. I can't think of a relationship with that. You don't particularly like that guy. Yeah, you know that. Of course you're aware of it. Or you like that guy here. He's nice here. He's cute here. He's whatever. Whatever you all say. you those guys, you would say, oh yeah, yeah, she's hot. Words may change, but you like the guy. Do you know you like the guy? Yeah, it took me some time because my emotions were being formed. You're aware of them. You're aware of the nebulous condition of your emotion. You're aware of the decisive nature of your emotion also. Can't be your emotions, my emotions, not I emotions. My decisions, not I decision. My knowledge, not I knowledge. I know things. I was there before I gathered the knowledge. So when you say I'm an engineer, I'm a doctor, I'm a scientist, I'm a this, I'm a monk, all that is from the standpoint of your knowledge. That self-identity, that self-judgment that you made about what you are is based on this, your knowledge. Sorry, it's an object of your awareness, not you. Hey, you're not yet introducing yourself to me. I'm asking you, who are you? I'm so and so. That name was given to you for consulting. Some grandmother, grandfather, or your parents chose a name for you. And then you had to hunt out whether that name is meaningful enough. Even for a monk, we change our names when you take sannyasa. But the name is not chosen by us, okay? The guru chooses that name. So the name is given to you. You are aware of it. You are different from it. You already existed before. Who are you? I still want to know the real you. Like in that movie, Bahubali. I have not yet known the real you. Who are you? Of course, he comes to a wrong conclusion. May ladka ho tu ladki. I'm a man and you're a woman. So there's only one relationship between man and woman. You can have 100 different types of relationships. Not that I'm against that relationship. Okay. So who are you? You have dismissed everything I know. Therefore, I must be ignorance. Unmanifest condition. Dark matter, ignorance. I can't accept that. Why? You are aware of your ignorance. Like if I were to ask here, does anybody here know Russian language? And assuming that nobody knows, if someone says, yeah, I know Russian, I'll say, okay, do you know Serbo-Croatian language? Serbo-Croat. The direct action. I don't know that. You know you don't know it? No, I'm very sure I don't know it. That means you're aware of your ignorance. My question still stands, what are you? At this level, you can say something very same. I'm the one who's aware of all this, the observer of all this. My body, my mind, my energy systems, the physiological systems, my emotions, my knowledge, my ignorance, all that I am aware of. So you are the awareer with respect to an object of awareness. That object can be from your ignorance down to the body to the whole world. Observer, awareer. Okay? With respect to yourself, what are you? Objectless awareness, that consciousness we talked about, that objectless consciousness is you. Self-evident. The absolute reality behind this whole universe. That was there before, in the beginning, before the universe was manifested, and what is there now. In the purest form, you will get it as you, the consciousness. Self-evident. The only thing self-evident in the world, the whole universe, is evident through a means of knowledge. In Sanskrit, we call it pramana siddham, established by a means of knowledge. Pramana means of knowledge, not authority. Okay? Some of you who are, I'm sure Vivekananda Circle is reading books on philosophy also. Reading books on Vedanta. Pramakaranam Pramanam. That which gives you Prama, knowledge, is called Pramana, not authority. So the Upanishads are looked upon as a source of knowledge for knowing the self. So this process I talked about is from the Upanishad. This is you. So in Vedanta, the consciousness is you. The only reality that is really there. Everything else, manifestation. And as manifestation, ephemeral. That I don't have to talk to a scientist. The scientist already knows the whole world is ephemeral, isn't it? Don't you not know that? So in the worldview, Vedanta and science seems to match. Why? Because what is there in the world? You can't say anything definite about anything. It's all based upon your observation. It's based upon your perception of the world, isn't it? Remember, everything is only because you see, hear, touch, etc. So the world is a dependent reality. You, the consciousness, is the independent reality. The independent reality in Vedanta is called Satyam. The dependent reality, the ephemeral reality, the unsure reality, the non-categorized reality is called as Mithya. Mithya doesn't mean illusion or delusion. You think of Mithya as an illusion, it's a big delusion. Because you are talking about this solid matter. Solid matter? Yeah, solid matter. It's a martial artist's hand. It'll go through bricks and wood and things like that. But is it matter? Is it solid? Nothing but atoms and molecules in motion. It's all vibrations. It is nothing but collapsed photon. Where is matter here? Where is matter? There's no matter. It looks like there is solid matter. Yes. That is true. If somebody walks into my fist, he will think there is solid matter after some time, not immediately. But what is it? Where is that solid matter? So in the world view, especially when you look at quantum physics and Vedanta, as the whole idea of Mithya, it seems to sort of agree. But the huge difference is that the whole thing is dependent on the consciousness that is there. The consciousness that was there at the beginning of the whole manifestation. That consciousness is dependent on. It is not an independent reality. That is why the very observation seems to be disturbing it. It seems to be responding to my observation because it is not an independent reality. It is not really speaking, even a separate reality. At the mind level, there is a connect. That is why it seems to be choosing its line. When one is blocked, the other one will choose. And when I talked about the cosmic mind, etc., many of you may find, if you're pure scientists in your thinking, you may find it difficult to take it. But look at it. Does the totality of the physical universe exist or doesn't exist? You, the individual world, exist. The individual person exists. The individual world that you see, your limited world, exists. So the totality has to exist. You are part of the totality. Your mind exists. So many minds exist here. 40 minds exist here. So the totality of minds is called the cosmic mind. The totality of knowledge, the intelligence that is there. Hey, that's why you all became scientists, because you could study and discover knowledge. You don't produce knowledge, do you? If you produce knowledge, you are in for big trouble, okay? That means you are falsifying your experiments and producing knowledge. You're in for a big problem. You're discovering what is there. The knowledge that is there is being discovered. So, in a practical way also, the whole world is nothing but collapsed knowledge. Look at this. I mean, look at this. is the seed of a banyan tree. Tiny. That tiny seed has a whole genetic programming for a tree that's going to last 500 years. When the secondary roots are going to come, how the branches are going to spread, what type of nutrients it will draw, how the roots will go into the soil, how when the secondary roots will come, under what conditions it will come, all that programmed into that small little seed. Genetic coding is what? Solidified knowledge. And what do you do with that solidified knowledge, that collapsed knowledge? Put into the soil. The software is put into the soil. And it grows into the hardware. Wow, if only you had software like that, that you plug it in and keep it in the whole computer. The same thing happened with you and me. Two cells, from one from your mother, one from your father, formed a zygote. So what type of a character this guy will be? Male or female first? Then, height. Whether there will be tendency to put on weight or not. At 50, chance of diabetes or not. At 60, chance of heart attack or not. At 85, Ram Naam Satya hai. All that is programmed into the two cells which you can't even see. What is it? Collapsed knowledge? That science is discovering? Great, great role for science. I always respect science. Okay? Because you have a great role in studying all that. Quantum physics, our advanced lasers, computers, all that has come from that. But the question of consciousness, I'm sorry, you'll have to come to Vedanta to know that. And it can be validated, like how you have experimental verification. Isn't that the process in science? You have to verify experimentally and see it. In Vedanta, you have to validate it. Each person has to validate their knowledge oneself. There's a process for that. There's a way of doing that. Until you can say, yes, that is true. I am that consciousness. So what is experimental verification? Validation there, here it is validation by yourself because you happen to be the consciousness. So there is a process of learning, there is a process of handling doubts, there is a problem, process of owning up that knowledge and validating it. All that is a part of Vedanta study. I talk for more than an hour. Is there any questions? I'm sure there should be questions. I'll be happy to answer if I can. Okay. In between, I'd seen some people raise their hand, some messages came. Sanchit Gupta has raised his hand or something.
Yeah,
but I can't see Sanchit here. Now I don't know whether I should shift to something here.
Pranam Swamiji.
Ah, yes, Sanchit. Bolo.
Okay. So my question is this one. Okay, I understood that it's difficult to explain matter or like consciousness emerging from matter.
Yeah.
At the same time, it seems like it's difficult to explain matter emerging from consciousness.
Correct.
So there is a block which neither science nor Vedanta can explain.
Good one.
So how do we know which one is real? And secondly...
Excellent question. Excellent question because... We don't say matter has emerged from the consciousness. Like how in science, consciousness is emerging from matter. For that, matter has to change a lot until it reaches a point where consciousness can emerge, isn't it? What about our process? Because from hydrogen and helium atoms, you have to form this brain. A long process of evolution has to happen.
Right.
And then you'll get this. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
In Vedanta, what we say is there is no production of matter.
Mm-hmm.
There is only an appearance of matter. Because what is matter? When you really look at it, it's only what you're experiencing. Touch, taste, sight, etc. Therefore, there's nothing but a certain form, a structure given to it. There's no real matter. is only one consciousness.
So
the matter is an appearance.
So if tomorrow science says that consciousness does not comes in matter but appears in matter, so will that be an accepted thing?
That will be more acceptable, but then you will have to say, then you will have to say that consciousness is already a potential in matter.
Okay.
Otherwise, how can it manifest?
Mm-hmm.
No, you can manifest only is there. What is there?
Right. Mm-hmm.
So it's a potential. Then that will come closer to Vedanta.
Okay.
But how are you going to decide that? Because the scientific process involves first objectification, then experimentation. And here we are dealing with I, the observer, I, the consciousness, not available for objectification or experimentation. But available for validation because it happens to be you.
Right, right.
So that is where the problem is. That's why we put Vedanta as a separate discipline of knowledge.
Okay.
It's a discipline of knowledge. It is not scientific. Because neither observation nor experimentation is possible. Nor generalization is possible because there is only one consciousness. These are the minimum requirements for it to become science, isn't it? Observation, experimentation, and replicating it, generalizing and replicating it. Generalization is not possible with only one consciousness. Is the observer not the object? Therefore, objectification is not possible. If objectification itself is not possible, what experiments you can do? But in science, you have done a lot of experiments. Yes, you have done. What are you experimenting with? The mind. Like Vivekananda Kendra in Bangalore itself, the Yoga Kendra, Vivekananda Yoga Kendra, is doing a lot of experiments with consciousness. But they are studying brain function and the neuroplasticity of the brain under meditation itself, which is true. I accept that. In fact, I had a Vedic Wisdom Festival organized last year in Bombay, where I got a friend of mine, who's a doctor, researcher, to talk about neuroplasticity of the brain. But you're still talking about brain function.
Right, right.
You're not talking about the consciousness that's occupying the brain. I'm talking about that consciousness. That's what Vedanta is talking about. The consciousness is objectifies all that you do and that you don't do also. A different ballgame altogether.
And also, one more question. Also, like, I understand that we say that matter, from the Vedantic standpoint, matter does not like is created, it appears in consciousness. So if really if I really take matter and consciousness to be different, I know the state of my body and mind. So if these two are really separate entities, how come I know the state of, for example, this pen, which or
good question
and all that?
Excellent question. So what can I use as an example? Okay, here's a book. Okay. This is a book. Matter?
Yes.
All right. Now let us look what the book is about. This book, only paper.
Right? Right.
So the content of the book is paper.
Right.
Paper is a reality, not book is only an appearance. In this arrangement, we will call it a book.
Right, right.
If it is clipped and filed together, it will be a file of papers. Okay. Paper, what is the reality of paper? Paper was once upon a time wood pulp. It was a tree. So wood pulp is a reality. Paper is an appearance. It's a name and form. Wood pulp in this name and form, you'll call paper. In another name and form, it can become something else. A piece in your drawing room or something.
Right, right.
So what is wood pulp? An arrangement of hydrocarbons. What is hydrocarbons? Arrangement of molecules. So hydrocarbon is only a form. The atoms are the substance. But atom itself made up of subatomic particles.
Right.
Finally, what is there? A concept. Because at certain level, all particles are only conceptualized. And you design an experiment with that concept in mind, you'll find it. You can find an opposite particle also if that is your concept and you design it. It finally is only born as a concept. So what is there as matter? You can't say nothing is there. Because this book is there. I'll whack you on the head with the book. You will stay whacked. I'll guarantee. He'll stay whacked. That means what? That consciousness itself is also given another name called existence. Tatyam. Therefore, in this book, Satyam is manifest, consciousness is not manifest.
Right.
For consciousness to be manifest, consciousness is there as Satyam. For consciousness to be manifest, the mind has to come in.
Okay.
Not brain. I'm talking of mind as a software in the hardware called brain. I look at brain as a hardware. Okay. And mind as a software in it. Now, this will become more evident only when we start doing brain transplants and things like that. That day is not far off. Heart, lungs, liver, etc. We have transplanted. Only left is brain transplant. If we can see how to connect the nerves at the spinal thing, we can do that. We have not yet figured that out. So, is matter, is the body really different? Yes. In the beginning, when you start this inquiry, it looks as though the body and mind are different things. Body and consciousness is different. But then you find what you held as different is nothing but a manifestation. Like a wave in the ocean, it looks as though it is separate. Looks, but actually is nothing but water. Right. Similarly, this body, mind, etc. looks separate, but is nothing but a manifestation. What is there is only one consciousness. So the whole of Vedanta is trying to understand this fact that not only I am consciousness, I am the basis for the whole universe. It's a big thing. Not a small thing. It's a big thing. So what you have started in your study circles is actually a big process, okay? You started it, so I'm very happy to see that. I said the moment you called me, I said, yes, of course, I'll be there.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Any other questions? Sure.
Thanks, Sanchit. Karthik has raised his hand. You can go next.
Nikhilesh Swamiji.
Yeah.
Namaste, Swamiji. Yes. It is actually as much an observation than anything else. If I ask myself two questions, one question is, am I aware? And the second question is, do I exist? Between that and saying yes, actually there are no thoughts at all, right? It is a kind of a blank, which itself shows that I am a self-evident, self-existing entity. Right?
That's why I say you don't need a process of mentation.
Right.
A process of thinking or a logical process you don't need. I am evident.
Yes. Yeah. And that feeling is actually universal. I think everybody has that same uniform.
Yep. Everybody has that.
Thank you so much.
Somebody has put something in the chat box?
Yes.
Because I just,
Yes,
what
Swami.
Is that?
Yeah. Shantanu Pramanik asks, he says he has two questions. The first one being, according to Vedanta, if the world is a perception, are sense organs necessary for perception? And the second one is, according to Vedanta, what is the status of an object when not being perceived?
Does it exist? Science also take the same stand. See, we have this big confusion that does an external reality is there or not there? For your functioning purposes, it is there. You'll have to look at it from two standpoints. Is there a cup of tea in the kitchen for me? All the ingredients are there. Said 8 o'clock, first thing I'll do is have a cup of tea. Then I'll do some little bit exercise, etc. Then I'll have my dinner. So, all those things are there even though I'm not seeing it right now. Okay. I know that there is dinner because my maid has cooked. I don't know what she has cooked. Nor am I bothered. Sadhu, kya bhi milega khane. So, as far as functioning purpose is concerned, you have to say that the external world exists irrespective of my perception. As far as the question of reality is concerned, you cannot say that. And this comes in because we are taking ourselves as one of the things in the universe. One entity here, looking at another entity there. Because of this, this divide of internal external comes in. If you look at it from the standpoint of consciousness, there is no internal external divide. Because of an entity that is there, you need the mind. And you need the sense organs to know what is external. You don't need sense organs to know what is internal. Do you like this guy? Yeah, I like him. How do you know? Which sense organ do you use? It's your mind. You don't need a sense organ. So what is inside, you don't need a sense organ. Only for outside, you need a sense organ, isn't it? I can't stand him. I hate that character. How do you know? Same thing. No, I think he's a nice friend. Relationship, no. Friends only. He's a good friend. All right. Keep him as a friend. Good. All that you know, no? You're aware of it without a sense organ. So what is inside, you know what is without sense organ. What is outside, you need a sense organ. Now, imagine with me. The cosmic mind. I said the first manifestation, no? Second manifestation, the cosmic mind. Is there anything outside the cosmic mind? For the cosmic mind, all creation, all universe is like how you created in dream. For you, in the dream, you have external, internal, isn't it? But it's all internal only. So the cosmic mind, everything is inside. You don't need a sense organ. You are aware of the whole thing. And it is a mind that produces matter. Every one of us is doing it. If I crack a PJ, poor joke. Okay. PJs are specially good. When the moment I mention PJs, people start laughing. See? That's the nature of PJ. Okay. Now, when you are laughing, endorphins are created in your brain. Not only in your brain, in every cell, including this, a cell in your toe has created those endorphins. How did you create it? Your mind, which in a certain state produces those hormones, chemicals, etc., in through only thought, but within your body, not outside your body. So mind creates matter all the time inside your body, not outside. Now, if I say the cosmic mind is Ishvara, God, Ishvara, Bhagavan, then all matter is created from the cosmic mind. You don't need anything to be created. Because the matter is mind. Matter evolves from the mind. Appears from the mind. Because remember again, what is matter? Fivefold way you are experiencing it. That's all that is matter. See, hear, touch, etc. All that. That's what you are calling matter anyway, isn't it? That's why I said existential philosophy and science matches very well. Where is the matter? It doesn't really matter. In fact, some scientists have joked like that. I found some videos on. Over 35 years, I've been studying matter. And now when I'm discovered there is no matter really, I think I'm talking Vedanta, not science. True. Worldview of science and Vedanta matches in this part, except the consciousness part and the mind part. Other than that, it matches very well. The ephemeral nature, etc., matches. Any other question that is there?
Swamiji, Nikhilesh Moiti has raised his hand. Yeah. Nikhilesh, you can go ahead.
Yeah.
Pranam, Nikhilesh.
Yeah. So, I have one question that You have mentioned that only the conscience means consciousness is exist, and other is the manifestation, not the creation also. And before the time and space, it was there. So my question is, so what was the necessity for this manifestation? What is the reason behind this?
All right. Now, again, the answer can be from two standpoints. One can be from our individual standpoint, because we are the one who's looking at the whole thing and saying, ye duniya banane wale kyon banaya the? Kyon banaya ye? So we are asking from our standpoint. If you are talking from the standpoint of consciousness, where the hell did I create anything? I did not manifest anything. This is how I am. Take it or leave it. This is me. What to do? We are like this only. Typical Indian answer you'll get. Enna raskala. This is me. I am like this only. That is the answer you'll get from consciousness, because that's it. This is me. Where did I manifest anything? Me, you. Because I'm there as consciousness all the time. So from the consciousness, let us leave it. Because the question is from our standpoint. From our standpoint, there can be a purpose in the world. What is the purpose? So that as an individual, we can grow, refine our thinking enough to understand that all that is there is only consciousness. Now, if you want a mystical answer, I can give you a mystical answer also. All manifestation is an attempt at me, the consciousness, trying to relate to me, the consciousness. And how can I, the consciousness, relate to myself unless it is through you? There are a lot of people who will fall for that. Okay? It has got some truth in it, okay? It has got some truth. But it is only for our growth. Because I am looking at it from the standpoint of a guy who is already born here, who has a horoscope, which looks like a horoscope. I mean, as a physicist or as a scientist, we don't believe in horoscopes. But we can't help reading the Sunday paper and what comes there. It's another discipline of knowledge. From our standpoint, it's only to grow until our minds can be refined enough to understand that all that is there is only consciousness. Look at it. That is why, see, the whole attempt at human life is to understand this totality. Let me give you an example of someone who's from liberal arts. No understanding of science. Okay. In fact, he or she took liberal arts so that he could avoid science and mathematics. Because in liberal arts, you can get by without science or mathematics. Okay. There are some very well-known colleges for this also. Okay. And he reads in the newspaper, we are closer to achieving the grand unified theory, etc. Some newspaper, some article was written. He reads it and he feels very happy. Even a newspaper article, he doesn't have enough science to understand that. But he feels happy. Genome sequencing of the whole world population has been done. Nice. Why? Why does he have to feel nice? He's not interested in science. He dumped it long back. So as soon as he go dump it after school, he dumped it. Now, why is he feeling happy? Because what you're looking for is this totality. Your understanding of the totality is what really the human mind wants. The hidden desire in you. It's an urge in you to understand that. That's why poets, scientists, philosophers all have looked into what is this whole. Mystics. Mystics have looked into it. Yogis have looked into it. From various standpoints, you have looked into it. Try to understand. Many have struggled. Why? Because the means of knowing that consciousness is from the Upanishads, that is missing in many people's lives, unfortunately. Even though the Upanishad was born and in this country, in this culture, we have become too secular. We reject our heritage, unfortunately. not the Vivekananda study circle, of course. All of you are owning up the heritage, but the others rejected. I mean, I'm sure all of you have an experience of speaking to a couple of friends and getting them, trying to get them into the circle, and they said, no, 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 we don't want anything to do with this. Time is not right for them. Leave it. Right time, they'll come. Because we have been fed in with too much of secularism. What do you mean, too much of secularism? Yeah, I respect secularism as what? What Gandhiji said, Sarva Dharma Samabhavaha. Respect for all religions. Treat all religions as the same. All religions are equal under the rule of law. I'll respect that. But that's not what we are doing. We are rejecting our heritage in the name of secularism. That's unfortunate. Unfortunate. That's what the British did to India. And we are continuing that. क्या करूं गुलामी की आदत आसान नहीं है छोड़ना दिस इज ऋषिकेश टॉक ओके ये गुलामी का आदत तो आसान नहीं है छोड़ने के लिए दैट इंटेलेक्चुअल स्लेवरी वी डोंट लुक एट आवर इंडिजिनस सिस्टम्स आयुर्वेदा इज ऑल जंक यू नो हाउ मेनी पीपल इन द विलेजेस हैव गॉट कोविड And we're treated only because by Ayurveda, because modern medicine is not available there. You should look at some of the village health centers that are there. There is one doctor who has failed half a dozen times. He's sitting down there. And he has got some basic first aid equipment. That's all, nothing more than that. Antibiotics, etc. There's no place selling that. You have to go to the nearest town, which is 20 kilometers away. I've been to villages like that. So what is the treatment available? And COVID has come up to there. What is the treatment available? Ayurveda. And they survive. But in the cities, we don't accept it. That's okay. You have your choice what type of treatment you want to take. Okay. I've also taken the vaccination, modern medicine. Yeah. What is good, take from every discipline. What is good in every discipline, take it. After all, Ayurveda is enough. To build a civilization of 6,000 years. Modern medicine is only 100 year old. Before that, what was there? Was there. And we built up a civilization which is 6,000 years old. We built up culture and music and dance and science. The first atomic theory was propounded in 1500 BC. Vaisheshikas. Dialectical. We don't know whether they had scientific methodology or not. Because all that manuscripts were lost when they burned on Nalanda, etc. Only some of the philosophical works survived. I'm not blaming anyone for it. I'm only talking about what happened. So because of this, we are not aware of our own heritage and our own culture, which is unfortunate. It's high time now we owned up that. At least the Vedanta part of it, because that's the most important in the world. Other disciplines, one form of medicine can be replaced with another form. It's okay. It's fine. Whatever works, works for you. Fine. As long as it works, I'm happy. Yeah, it works. Yeah, because finally, what is it? It's a paradigm. If you're having a paradigm, like talking about paradigms and how it works, you get a stomach upset. Sunday, no doctors available. Only that Ayurvedic character is available next to you. They will examine your pulse. Okay? Their examining of pulse is three places, not one place. Okay? It's a three-fingered approach. What they're reading is a different paradigm altogether. I'm aware of that paradigm, but it's a huge different thing. But three places they will feed your pulse. And then he'll tell you the air is disturbed. The Panchabhuta called air is disturbed in you. Air is disturbed. So I will give you a Vayu Gulaga, air tablet. Well, what is this? What hocus pocus is talking about here? So he gives you an air tablet with some water. He says, stomach. And he's sitting right there and you don't have any other solution. Your stomach is creating too much of issues for you. So you take it and you drink that water. And after a couple of hours, you find, hey, that's okay. Yeah. I'm feeling nice. I'm feeling better. So after 4 hours, he has asked me to take a second tablet. I'll take that now only. It works. It's a different paradigm. Yeah. Does it work? Yeah. Use it. Doesn't work, forget it. Whether you use allopathy or homeopathy or Ayurveda or anything, finally you'll have my sympathy. Why? Nothing will work. A tad will come and nothing will work. Like this person who is always was fond of saying, "Arey, mera time to aa jayega. Abhi tak aaya nahi. Mera time aayega. Mera time aayega." You will understand enough Hindi for this, I think. From looking at the names, I am sure all of you understand that much. My time will come. My time will come. Finally, he was admitted to the hospital, and the doctor said, "His time has come. Inform all the relatives." So finally, nothing will work. In between, everything will work, up to a point. So do what works. Use what works. Be pragmatic enough to do what works. Don't get conditioned by ideology and this thing. What works, works. But I'm a scientist. Yes, I have scientific temper and I'll follow it in my profession, in my life also, I'll bring it as far as possible. But everything is not governed by that. There are things outside that discipline also. Like I can't say everything is works in Vedanta. Vedanta won't give me food, clothing, shelter. Yeah, it's true. Unless I start my own religion. Then I'll become rich. But I don't do that. I refuse to do that. I refuse to commercialize this. So what works, works. Do it. So any other questions that you have got or anyone is having?
Any other questions? Sanchit, you want to ask something?
Yeah, thank you. So, Swamiji, how does Vedanta solve the problem of suffering? Which was initial.
Yeah. Okay. Now, again, when you talk about suffering, you're talking at the functioning aspect, isn't it?
Yes, yes.
So, you can look at it very pragmatically and say, even Vedantins do that.
Mm-hmm.
Suffering is part of life. No?
Mm-hmm.
Heat and cold with the changing weather is bound to be there.
Right, right.
No, but take it in your stride.
Right.
Otherwise, but they will say it is karmic.
Okay.
Karma, karma, phala.
Because but this also I have observed, sorry to interrupt.
Yeah.
The moment I remember this knowledge and try to be a witness, the suffering reduces. So why does that happen?
Because you're not really the body. You're only associated with the body. So when you create a little dissociation, suffering drops. Similarly, you're not the mind. You're independent of the mind. When you create that little space, that distance, the suffering reduces.
Okay.
It's like supposing you got into an accident.
Mm-hmm.
The car suffered some damage. You are fine. What will you say? Hey, mm-hmm. I'm okay. What you get? Car has got some damage. Okay. I'll have to sell out some money. Some the insurance will cover it. But you're okay. Mm. Na? The same thing happens with suffering. So the cause of suffering, and we will say, it's karmic. Past karmas. Because your life is not over with this one lifetime.
Yes.
Because if you talk about you as being an individual, independent of the body, then there is before and there is later. So in the theory that is propounded, okay, pure Vedanta doesn't bother. If this pure Vedanta will say, where is suffering?
Right.
As consciousness, what suffering is there? It's only for your body mind. But pragmatically, when you look at it, one of the things brought in will be your karmic thing. So because of certain actions that I'm getting, what goes around comes around. So I am getting this problem. I'll go through it. I'll do something to change it. Because it is not what happens to me that creates my life. It is my response to what happens that creates my life, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Right, right.
Especially when you're young, you should remember this very well.
Mm-hmm.
It is not what happens to you. It is not the situations that dictate terms and create your life. It is how you respond to the situation that creates life. that makes your life. Like today in the paper I was reading, this girl, she's living on the footpath. All classes are online. She's living on the footpath under a sheet, plastic sheet, to protect her from the rain. But she has passed her 10th standard. And she's coaching her younger brother to pass. Wow. Is she dictated by her circumstances? Or she's taking charge of her life? Difficult. Can you imagine more difficult circumstances than Bombay rains? Oh my God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We sit at home and we complain, oh my God, trains are not working, this is not working, that's not working. Half the city is flooded, we crib about it. Where we are all nice, happy, everything is fine. No, we crib. And that kid, in that condition, my God. So it is always your response to a situation that creates your life. So go by the response. Okay, there is a situation, karmic. I will respond. Result, that's also part of my future karma. Present karma is creating future karma.
Right.
So another question that I saw on the thing was, what does it take about liberation? Liberation is this. When you understand your limitless consciousness, you identify with that limitless consciousness. You're free from the issues, from the karmic issues, suffering issues, anything. That's why that limitlessness is also presented as ananda. Ananda meaning, look at it. All right, let me give you an example for this. Here is a person, morning, is getting ready to go to work. His wife puts a sheaf of papers in front of him. What is this? This is a divorce. I got fed up of this marriage. The divorce papers, please sign it. Can we at least talk about it? What is it? Completely blindsided. Okay. There's nothing to discuss. Here are the papers. Either you can talk to my lawyer. Okay, I'll come back. I have an important meeting in the boss. I'll come back and we'll talk about it. There's nothing to talk. Upset and angry, he drives to work. There, because he's still upset and this thing about the whole thing, he picks up a fight with the boss. Boss says, that is what your feelings are, put in your papers. You can quit now. Personal relationship gone, professional relationship gone. He's driving home, worried, upset, angry, everything. Meets with an accident, lands up in the hospital with two broken ribs and one broken leg. And his friend goes to cheer him up. What cheer are you talking about? Personal relationship gone, professional relationship gone, health in a problem. Situation bad enough? Or you want to make it worse? Can you make it worse? Worse will be he dies. Then problem solved. Next life can be clear. This is bad enough. And his friend goes there. What cheering up can you do? Tell me, what can you tell this guy to cheer up? So the friend does what typical men will do. What a typical man will do. He cracks a joke. He cracks a joke. And the guy starts laughing. He is holding on to his ribs because when he's laughing, he's like, but he's still laughing. Tell me, from where did that joy come in? Is there anything to be joyful in his life? If you're looking at the situation in life, nothing to be joyful about. When this limitless nature of your consciousness manifests in your mind, it is called ananda, joy. So ananda is an implied statement indicating the limitless nature. Ananda is not to be taken literally. It implies your limitlessness. You are always in a satisfied, full condition, totally in harmony with everything. Even if your mind is going in sixes and sevens. So it is ananda there is going through a happy situation, a party time, happy situation. It is Ananda that is going through a miserable situation. Is your Ananda? Is Ananda going through a challenging situation? It is Ananda that is going through a painful situation. You are always Ananda. That is liberation. Situation is painful. Have you not experienced like that? Situation is a pain, but you are happy. Go on a monsoon trek and see what happens. Blistered feet, aching shoulders, food that you would never look at when you are at home. Half burnt, half undercooked. But you come back and say, hey, I had a great time on the trek. Situation is miserable actually. But nobody comes back from a trek and says it is miserable. It is challenging, but it is good. It is challenging, but it was fun. Because you can be happy in a miserable situation. Because you are doing something, you are challenging yourself. There are different reasons for it, psychological reasons, for that ananda to manifest. So whenever that infinite nature of yourself manifests, when your mind, it generally happens experientially for us, when your mind is arrested, like the joke, your mind is arrested there. Or you're walking on the street, just walking. And suddenly the full moon appears in front of you. Ah, beautiful. Mind is arrested. The ananda that manifests itself. You're going by a vehicle. And in the next vehicle, there's a gurgling baby making faces. You look at it and you start smiling like a grinning gorilla. You especially if I start smiling with all my hair and all that. Why? Your projecting mind is arrested. You are longing for something, you got it. Your mind was projected into that desire. You got that object of desire, ananda. But because you are ignorant of your true nature, that ananda seems experientially covered up again. That ignorance covers up. So you can't always be ananda. You can be only ananda in bits and pieces like this. That's what keeps you going in life. That hope that... कभी खुशी कभी गम ना सो खुशी तो आता है ना कभी कभी इट कीप्स यू गोइंग विच इज गुड आई डोंट नो एनी अदर क्वेश्चंस और व्हाट
हेलो स्वामी जी
या
Yeah, so continuing to the just previous question of Sanjit, I have one doubt here. So, if one person, just I am trying to formulate this question in this way, that if one person has the misery or you can say the suffering in the means worldly things, that if he is saying that so many work is there and all those things. And if suddenly, if he realizes that I am not body, not mind, not even the panchakoshas, any part, then he feels basically happy, or basically he feels the peace. So my question is that this peace or happiness is the happiness or peace of the consciousness, or this is feels by the mind.
When you are experiencing happiness, it is happiness manifesting in your mind. And the question is, from where did that happiness come?
Yes.
It can come only from the aspect of consciousness. Because there is no place called happiness. Is there? You go to this place, automatically you'll become happy. Is there a place like that? No. Swamiji, your ashram set up in Rishikesh, so beautiful with the Ganga flowing by, the mountains there. Ah, it's heaven on earth. For you, when you come there for a visit, for the locals, whenever I go to Rishikesh, I get at least 2-3 people coming and asking me, Swamiji, aap Bombay se na? I said, haan, Bombay ke. Kuch kaam milega? Driving, yaan. I know driving, will I get some job? And I always ask them, where do you want to live this beautiful place and go to Bombay? Bombay mein kuch nahi hai, Mayapuri hai. Nothing is there in Bombay, it's a crowd and this and that. It's so beautiful here. And he tells me, Swamiji, what is there here? There is water, there is mountain, there is nothing else. So there is no place called happiness, there is no time called happiness. Happy hours is not really happy hours. Okay? Mm-hmm. Happy hours makes you drink earlier. very happy situation for the bar owner because he gets more money. And you feel happy because you're getting it cheaper. Forgetting that he's making you spend earlier and longer. There is no time, there is no place, there is no person called happiness, is there? I knew a girl called Anandi, she was always miserable. There is no quality. Yeah, happiness belongs to this. Then you only have to get that thing. So where does that happiness come from? From yourself. Don't say from inside you, okay? Inside you, what do you have? Heart, which is subject to getting an attack. Liver, which is subject to bloating. Pancreas, which is subject to failing and getting diabetes. So inside you, what is there? All problems only. Not when you're young, you get a bit older. Okay. God's grace, not yet. Okay. So, when you say you are experiencing, it's manifest in the mind is what you call joy, happiness, etc. By yourself, the simple ananda, limitlessness. When it manifests, you are happy, etc. Okay. Someone else had raised their hand.
Ji Maharaj ji.
Boliye Rohit.
Sir, my question is, see, this consciousness which you talk about, like what you have explained, we all are this consciousness, one and the same. So my question is, are there examples of people who have established in that knowledge?
Yep.
Who have understood this, that we are consciousness? So my question is, who are these people, if there are any? Second question is, how did they reach there? And third is, how can we do that?
Most important, yes. Are there examples of people? Yeah, you belong to Vivekananda study circle. So Swami Vivekananda himself was one of them. His guru was one of them. There are a lot of disciples who have reached that stage. In every generation, you will find people who know the truth. Every generation will find that. People who have known the truth. Only thing is, there is no external signs for you to make out. They may appear as normal as the guy next door. Yeah. Okay, some of us wear the robes. But my knowledge will be still the same if I come to you in front of you with a t-shirt and jeans. Okay. You think it'll change?
No.
I can wear a pair of t-shirt and jeans anyway. When I practice my martial arts, I'm not wearing my dhoti and my kurta and everything. There are always in every generation, people who have known the truth. How did they know? The Upanishad is very clear. Atmavare Shrotavya, you have to listen to a traditional teacher unfolding it. Mantavya, you have to reflect upon it, challenge your understanding, clarify all doubts, etc. Nididhyasitavyaha, you have to contemplate it to make it your own, to validate and make it your own. So this is the process. Any person in India who got this on the world, who got this knowledge, got it like this. From the time of the rishis to now, and I'm sure in the future generation also. Why? Because some of my students have become teachers. Three, four of them who have become teachers themselves. So all of them also got the same way. So you're making a start by a study circle and you're calling in teachers. Yeah, because that's how all of us began. It's a good beginning. But it can be a little bit confusing also because you're exposed to various people, various ways of presenting, various topic ways presenting. So it may not become always holistic. So that's okay. That's how we all started. You need a general understanding before you get into serious study. And serious studying doesn't mean you can't do it along with your jobs, your careers, your relationships, your kids, etc. You can do it along with all of that. All our rishis were happily married people. Okay? Not unhappily married. They're all happily married. There are 500 rishikas mentioned in the Veda. Women who had this knowledge. 500 rishikas. Not a small number. So man, woman is not based on caste or creed or religion or your sex or your sexual preference also. It's not based on any of those things. Yeah. It's based on this and what you know.
Ji Maharaj. So,
yeah. So that is the approach. That's what you take. I'm sure you'll get reached there.
Yeah. So Yes, Maharaj. Huh? So how was life after that? Like after one is establishing that knowledge, one knows that everything is consciousness.
If you know the truth and then you die, you remain as pure consciousness. If you don't know the truth and you die, then you'll have to take another birth, another life to continue your journey until you know.
Ji Maharaj.
Now, I can't prove this to you until I do a past life regression for you. Then you can see your own past lives. I can help you see that. Then you'll know, Hare, I was there that time also. 200 years back, I was there. You can say that. But until then, this can't be proved in a laboratory setting. But you'll have to, this is what the Shastra says. That you have to take another birth and continue your journey until you know the truth.
Ji Maharaj ji. And Shastra also say the importance of Guru. So, I want to ask this question. What is the importance of Guru? Because we read all these things in from Upanishads, from commentaries of Shankaracharya, from commentaries by Vivekananda. We read that. We discuss that also. But what is the importance of Guru? I want to ask, and how to find the right Guru and all.
Yeah. Because remember, the whole thing that you're reading and everything is finite words. And the consciousness is limitless, infinite. So through finite words, you have to understand infinite. So that cannot be a printed word. A printed word will help you get a general knowledge about it. But through finite words, if the infinite has to be revealed, you need a master communicator who can use those words in such manner. Like I use the word awareness. And from that word awareness, I drop all that you are not. I use the paradigm of science, I use CRC and everything. If you notice what I did with all here, including time, space, everything I negated from the word awareness. And revealed that word awareness, which is a finite word, awareness, consciousness, to be limitless. Isn't that what I did with all of you? It looked as though I was talking science. But what I was doing, really speaking, was taking that word consciousness and from there negating all the limitations until the limitless meaning you all got a glimpse of. Many of you here got a glimpse of it and said, yeah, that's correct. So that is the role of a teacher, only to communicate. So you need that live teaching. A guru who is dead and gone can be a great inspiration. Vivekananda was my inspiration also. Which English speaking person has not started on the spiritual journey without reading Vivekananda? Nobody has. Nobody has. If you're doing it in English, you have to read Vivekananda. We all have done that. Then we graduated into higher levels of learning. Yeah. Where you learn from a live teacher. Yeah. Because the subject matter is huge. You don't have to study the whole literature to understand yourself. Okay? It depends on how ready your mind is. So certain qualifications are mentioned, what type of a mind will understand the truth, etc. So get that. Because is there any discipline of knowledge without qualification? Supposing I want to get a doctorate in physics, study the nature of time-space relationships. How will I get the doctorate? The first question, when I go to register, will be, do you have a master's degree? I don't. Are you a graduate in physics? No, in engineering. Oh, okay. Engineering can be considered graduation. So you do your master's in physics. Correct? That's how the process will be now. So even though I read a lot of physics, it is still my reading. But at least physics is an object. You can do some studies. Here we are talking about the subject. And the subject which is infinite. And that is revealed only through words. There is nothing else available. And you have to validate that in your own reflection and meditation. So a live teacher becomes very, very necessary. It's okay if you can't get him now, because all of you are, I think, postdoc, doctorate students, master students, doctorate students.
Yes, ma'am.
So it's okay. Along with that, like how I studied, along with engineering and all I studied. So keep the study going like that. Like Vivekananda Circle is good. Once a month you call some speaker, so you get some better insights. You'll get some. This will go on. So along with everything else you study. It's like, why did you become a monk? Because I wanted to go on the expressway. Some of my friends took the scenic route. They got married and things like that. Aram, say, you go reach the truth in time. I was in a hurry, so I took the expressway. You're not in a hurry, take the scenic route. It works. Both works. You'll reach the same end. And you need to mature out in life. Get your heart broken once or twice, at least. Necessary. You know? People come and ask me, Swamiji, like you, I also want to take it full time. The first question I ask them is, have you fallen in love? No, never. Forget it. You're not ready to study Vedanta. Go. Fall in love. At least once. Yeah. Love is, if you're ready to understand another person, you're ready to understand anything. Yeah. And falling, therefore, falling in love is important. You will understand the difference between projection and reality. Big lesson, I'm telling you, a big lesson in life. No amount of talking will teach you that, like falling in love is the best thing for that. And that's a great experience. It's, yeah, do it. Now, I'm sure there are a lot of questions that people might. Swamiji, have you? I have, okay. That's why I'm talking about it. Long back, but I have. Not once, twice. Two serious relationships, okay? Before I became a monk. Yeah, I'm honest about it. I'm transparent. I know all this is being recorded. So what? I'll declare it to the world. What I am is, what you see is what you get. It's important, because it's an important part of your learning and growth. Very important part. Have you gone through your teenage rebellion? People come and say, my son is rebelling. He's only 15. Very good. Well, if you don't rebel at 15, if you don't do that, you'll do it at 25. If you don't do it at 25, you'll do it at 50. Create a mess of your life. The better it happens at 15. This is the right time and place for everything. It should happen. So that way, go through life, experience life, see the joys and sorrows of life. Achha. Then you are ready to understand what's beyond that. Anything else that you want to do or what?
Swamiji, the person who asked about what Vedanta says about liberation, Nagananda Chandrasekhar, he had mentioned in answer to that some fleeting instances where you can still feel happy although everything in your life is going wrong. So you'd given an example of a person like that. So I think he
wants some more examples.
He picked up from there and he asks that, but these are fleeting instances, but liberation is something that is eternally sustained happiness. So correct. How to attain it?
Simple. Ravanam mananam nididhyasa. The Shastra is very clear. Listen, study the Shastra. Study the Pramana that deals with this knowledge. Reflect upon it, clarify all your doubts, etc. Contemplate enough to make the knowledge your own. There's no shortcut to that. Live your life in the spirit of Karma Yoga. What is Karma Yoga? In a nutshell, acceptance of all that is there. Think clearly, feel strongly, act decisively. Think clearly, feel deeply, act decisively. And the result comes, the consequences, you're ready to face it. You accept it. Live like that. And study. That's how everyone got it. Yeah, that's how everyone has got it, speaker included. Okay, as I said, I took the fast track by taking, walking out of my home, my job, everything. If you're ready for that, fine. If you're not ready for that, don't do it. You can't go on the expressway unless your car is in good condition. Otherwise, you have a major breakdown and a major accident. Guy has not fallen in love before. And he goes and joins an ashram. What do you think will happen? He'll fall in love with somebody there. Yeah, I'm not joking. I've seen so many of it happening. And then is a problem now. You go back to life, you can't continue here, you can't go back. Problem. So, take up to that when you are ready for it. There's an expression in Hindi, you know. Sau chuhe khake, billi haj par gaya. Have you heard that expression? After eating 100 rats, the billi went on haj pilgrimage. The cat went on a pilgrimage. That's the right thing. Finish all your experience of life and things like that. And when you're fine, because this is we are talking about emotional maturity. We are not talking about your maturity in terms of age or gray hair. My first streak of gray hair appeared when I was 25. What are you talking about? So, your maturity is what matters. I have seen many mature 25-year-olds and mature 80-year-olds. Yeah. At 80, you will expect a person has been there, done that. So the person was feeling lonely. So I asked him, why don't you get married? Just to see his reaction. What should he be telling? At 80, what marriage, etc. What time is gone for all that? Now for me, time is for other things. You know what he said? Who will give me a girl? That means the longing for a relationship is still there. Nothing wrong if the longing is there. But the thing is that maturity has not been there yet. At 80, I can joke further on it, but I'm holding myself back. I don't want to scandalize you. Yeah, because as a sadhu, some of my jokes can be scandalous, okay? Because I was a sailor before I became a monk, okay? So, yeah. So it's 8:10. Yeah. No, shall we call it a day or what?
No, no. I didn't mean to interrupt you. I thought.
No, no. I was just going to say this. One. Yeah. I'm fine. Okay. If you all want to continue.
I wanted to ask a question too. One question is that there were certain German philosophers who, for example, there's an article which is called "Science's Falsification" or paradigm shift. So they basically say that science grows through falsification of a previous theory to accommodate a broader horizon of phenomena. So I want to know how Vedanta grows or whatever, or is it that whatever is there to know through Vedanta is already known?
Yeah. Very good question. Excellent question, because all over the world, in all disciplines of knowledge, not only according to science, there is a thesis, there is an antithesis, and there is a synthesis. Isn't this the process? You propound a thesis. Somebody makes a modification, antithesis. You can write something against you also, against that also. Then a new person will try to synthesize both. This happens a lot in non-scientific matters. You know? Thesis, synthesis. I mean, thesis, antithesis, synthesis. In science, though, so if you are doing a doctorate, doesn't every theory have a potential for falsification? For falsification, it has to be there in your thesis. Maybe your guides have not highlighted this part of it, but it is there. That any theory propounded should have a limitation, because all theories will work only in a framework. You shift the framework, it is gone. Like Newtonian physics worked under a certain framework. Einstein in physics changed the whole framework. So that is how science progresses. That is how any theory in the world progresses. That is the evolution of thought. In Vedanta, the first text that talked about it, the Upanishad, said you are consciousness. And the latest writer in Vedanta also says you are consciousness. In that way, there is no evolution. But where does the evolution take place? When you are discussing other schools of thought. Like there was a time in India when Nyaya Vaisheshika was high. Nyaya Vaisheshika is a forerunner of science. Okay, Vaisheshika is a forerunner of science. So Vedanta had to answer some of those questions. So the writers of that time answered those questions. Today the questions come from science, so we have to answer those questions. So that way there is an evolution. But the core remains the same, your consciousness. That doesn't change, whether it's Upanishad or now. If it changes, then you're not talking Vedanta. Because remember, all of Vedanta is to understand your consciousness, right from the beginning of time. And how old is Vedanta? You don't know. In fact, there was one of the rishis who was supposed to have discovered and got fire from the gods. That means you are talking about rishis in prehistoric times, and even fire was not there. But they knew they were consciousness. What a scientific development when fire itself was not developed. They didn't know how to make fire. But they knew they were eye consciousness. Angiratha, I think, was a rishi who said that. So from that time onwards, you know that your consciousness doesn't change. Everything else can change. How you explain creation, how you explain the world, how you explain certain things. So that will change from audience to audience. I take a class in Bombay. But in one group, I'll explain in some manner. Another group, I'll explain in some other manner, because the audience is different in front of me. So I have to make some fine tuning to the audience. That's why I said, please put on your video so that I can see you all. I can see your responses, the subtle responses that happen in your eyes and your face, which makes me know, oh, you're understanding or not understanding. However much of a poker face you keep. The fine changes always happens. And if it is, I prefer the live audience, naturally. Why? Because I can sense your energy, I can sense your mind, I can sense so many things. So the understanding is much better than. So as a teacher, I have to make out now whether people are following me or not. What is the point in me speaking if nobody is following? Then I'll jump there and talk in a manner where people can follow. I don't come prepared. This is what I have to say. No. I'm spontaneous in terms of my audience. Did it look like a prepared talk? That's why there is no slides. There is no screen sharing and slides. And this is old traditional teaching. Live, spontaneous, as it is to the audience in front. And we said, okay, I will start with the paradigm of science because that is audience. General knowledge that I have about the audience. They're all science students, doctorates, postdocs, working for your doctorate, etc. So, okay. So that is why there is evolution of thought is in these things. That is called the tradition of teaching. The live tradition of teaching that allows this change to happen. And the core remains the same. And there are certain basic principles that you will enter to in the teaching. That's a bit technical, so I'm not going into that now. Yeah.
Thank you, Swamiji. Another question, slightly convoluted. So you said, like, to know that your consciousness is to know the truth. However, suppose someone knows, realizes really, not just intellectually, actually comes to realize that they are consciousness. Do they know all the truths of all the workings of the world, or is science required? Isn't science required? Don't both of them pursue truth?
Okay, let us assume I know the truth. After all, the team, my guru has given me that name, Brahmavid, one who knows Brahman. Okay, I don't know head or tail of what is of this laptop in front of me. That's why I had to ask you all to send me a link by email, because I didn't know how to share and transfer that from my phone WhatsApp message to the laptop. I have a WhatsApp icon on the laptop, but I struggled. I had to go on it, scan it, this, that, etc. So I told, hey, please send it. So it'll become easier for me just to click on it. You know what I'm trying to say? That you don't know everything. Why? Because your mind is limited. As you, the consciousness, you are limitless. But your mind is not the cosmic mind. The cosmic mind has all knowledge in it. Some yogis have this knack of connecting up with the cosmic mind. When you can connect up, you will get insights from the conscious mind, from the cosmic mind into your mind. But only some links you will get. You can download a few things. But your small little mind, pokey mind, is not huge enough to hold all that knowledge. That only the cosmic mind will have. But the knowledge of the limitless, that your consciousness, that your mind can hold. Why? Because the mind is non-different from that consciousness. But your mind is different from all other things that are there in the world. So you'll need science, you'll need finance. In today's world, everyone requires some working knowledge about all this. No? Some working knowledge about science. Some working knowledge about finance. Otherwise, you'll work all your life and still remain poor. So you need some working knowledge of finance. You need some working knowledge of biology, of health, etc. I mean, you don't do a doctorate in nutrition, but basic you need to know. But all knowledge you can't have. How many doctorates can you have? 2, 3? I knew somebody who had 3, 4 doctorates. More than that you can't have. Because your mind can't hold all that knowledge. It'll blow your mind out. So you need knowledge of all other things. Including how a South Indian mommy will make a cup of coffee. Can you make it like that? There is so much of standardization and wisdom that has gone in making the typical coffee that you'll go to Bangalore to what? Your Sarvana Bhavan or something and get it. Unbelievable. The level of, hey, you don't have that. It takes a lot of time to learn how to do that. You need a mother-in-law to teach you, only then you get it. Yeah. So, a lot of knowledge you won't have. You know, you all mentioned Taranandagiri, whom I studied from. He had left home when he was 16. And he had studied in Sanskrit colleges after that. So, basic science he didn't know. He used to ask me, "Acha, aapke guru kahan hai?" Because my guru, Swami Dayananda Saraswati, was also his student. And he was in States on a lecture tour at that time. That Swamiji to USA mein hai aisa. Acha, to udhar abhi baat karta rahega? Nahi Swamiji, wahan to abhi raat hai. Sota rahega wo. Acha, wahan sota rahega? Kaisa raat hai wahan? He did not know this. He knew I am consciousness and he could explain it in a manner which was phenomenal. I always bow down to him. But these things he picked up from me. That's okay. Remember, prehistoric times onwards, this knowledge has been there. Yeah, so this, all these things are picked up. Some were very intelligent, very knowledgeable. Some of the rishis were hugely knowledgeable about other disciplines also. Some stuck to the fact of consciousness. So you find modern teachers are also like that. Some are contemporary enough to know about other things. Some are remaining as traditional. That's okay. That's their choice. What are you going to study for? My contemporariness helps me to relate with any audience. That's all. So it's easier for my students to relate to me. Whereas if the traditional teacher like Taranandagiri who's staying that time in Haridwar, you have to make all the effort to relate to that. Whereas a more contemporary, it is easier to relate to. So that's the only difference. So those things you need to still know.
Thank you, Swamiji. If there are no further questions, then probably we should.
I'm sure everyone is feeling hungry, that's why. That's okay, that's good, that's good. I'm joking, okay, please continue.
Yeah, so there are no further questions. I'd like to, on behalf of the Vivekananda Study Circle at ISC, as well as all the attendees here, I'd like to thank Swami Brahmavedanandaji for his extremely thought-provoking talk, very logically and rationally built to naturally invoke the necessity and need for the concept of consciousness. So thank you very much. And I'd also like to thank a couple of people from VSC. The person who contacted Swamiji, people who made the poster, people who allowed people into the meeting, person recording this video. And thank you all very much. And I'd like to tell all the attendees who are not a part of the Vivekananda Study Circle that if they are interested, they can definitely join the circle by leaving their email IDs in the chat box. And it'll be you will be included in the emailing list. And we'll receive a link to attend the weekly meetings.
Yeah, I told a few students, you know, that, so some of them have been here. Yeah.
Okay.
In fact, one of the students is one, she was here for some time, was Dr. Geeta Dore. She passed out from the Institute of Science.
Okay.
Years ago, of course, many years. She's a psychiatrist and she knew your Dr. Sheshadri. Dr. Sheshadri was the elder brother of a well-known actress during her time, Meenakshi Sheshadri. That's all before your time. Before your time. We are talking about the 80s when she was an actor there, an actress. So she was here for some time now. She's a graduate of, a postgraduate from your place, the doctorate in psychiatry.
Yes, Maharaji, thank you.
And thank you all.
I'd just like to end with the Shanti Mantra.
Please do. Yeah, that's a good idea to do that.
Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
Good, I enjoyed being with all of you. Okay. I see that you are a good bunch of seekers. I won't put you all just as mere students. I think all of you are seekers. It's good to see that. Okay, and one offer I make to everyone is, any of you who, once you sit in my lecture, etc., you want to get in touch with me, discuss certain things, I'm available, okay?
Yeah, Swamiji, I wanted to ask you if you could leave for all our, all the people here, if you could leave your email address in the chat box.
How do I leave that?
Maharaj, I'll share with them.
Okay, go to the chat box and send a message. All right. Here, oops, what happened? Okay. Send a message.
Maharaj, I have shared with them.
Yeah. Oh, you have shared it.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, you have shared it. Okay. You're faster. Now you know how much I have in my computer skills. I have to look and type. You see, you don't get all knowledge. Okay. Take care, all of you.
Bye. Thank you, Swamiji, very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Swamiji.
Thank you,
Swamiji. Take care.
Thank you, Swami.
Take care to all of you. Yeah. Good night and
good night.
Enjoy your dinner. Yeah. So someone is How do you do this? You close the meeting or what?
You can directly close the tab. Nothing else is required.
Okay. Hold.
Okay, Swamiji, I'll end the meeting then from here.
Yeah, whatever, that's fine. Okay, I'm just putting off closing a few things here. Yeah.
Oh, okay, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, Sanchit, I'll leave.
Yeah, thank you, Devi.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks.